praise. We worship the God who was, we worship the God who is, and we worship the God who always will be and who is to come. Amen. Father, we just lift up our hearts as we sing these songs. They are songs of love, songs of praise, songs of thanksgiving, songs of hope. Would you come meet with us today? We lift up your name. Amen.
Worship the God who evermore will be. He opened the prison doors. He parted the raging sea. My God, he holds the victory. Yeah, there's joy in the house of the Lord. There's joy in the house of the Lord today. And we won't be quiet. We shout out and pray. There's joy. The Lord, our God is surely in this place. We won't be quiet. We shout out our praise. Shout out your praise. We sing to the God who heals. We sing to the God who saves. We sing to a God who always makes a way. Cross, then he rose up from that grave. My God, still rolling stones away. There's joy in the house of the Lord. There's joy in the house of the Lord today. And we won't be quiet. We shout out and pray. There's joy in the house of the Lord. Their God is surely in this place. We won't be quiet. Now we're royalty. We were the prisoners. Now we're running free. We are forgiven, accepted, redeemed by his grace. Let the house of the Lord sing praise. Sing that. We were the beggars, but now we're royalty. We were the prisoners.
We are gathered here to worship you. To worship you. Worship you, Jesus. Lord, let your glory fall as on that ancient day. Songs of enduring love, and then your glory came. And as a sign to you that we would love the same, our hearts will sing that song. God, let your glory come.
Was made, and then your fire came. They knelt upon the ground, and with one voice they praise. This is our praise. You are good, you are good, and your love endures. You are good, you are good, and your love endures. You are good, you are good, and your love endures today. Yeah.
when we've been there 10,000 years, bright shining as the sun. We've no less days to sing your praise than when we first begun. Heaven is a wonderful place. Lord, we are so longing to be there with you in eternity. Our life is a vapor. It's a journey. Each one of our stories intricately interwoven by your hands. You make no mistakes. God, we worship you and we ask you to give us a vision of heaven. Let us see that it's only by your grace that we've come this far. And it's only by your grace that you will lead us home. I rest my soul on Jesus when the mountains shake. I put my trust in Jesus the moment I awake. And when my soul is lost at sea, he will be my rock, my vision be in Christ alone. This grace is all we've got. His love is like a mighty ocean. His love for me will never stop. Oh, his arms are strong enough to carry me through it all by the grace of God. So high upon his shoulders, so high upon his shoulders, safely brought this far. Helper of my helpless soul, King of broken hearts, his love is like the mighty ocean. His love for me will never stop. Oh, his arms are strong enough to carry me through it all by the grace of God. You are the passion of my life, Lord Jesus. You are the song within my soul, my strength, my hope, my all in all is you, Jesus, you. When breath grows still and night draws near, I will not be afraid. I know the plans he has for me don't finish at my grave. Oh, his love by the grace of God. Through it all, by the grace of God. By your grace we stand.
Lord God, we've come into your house to worship you this day, to lift our hearts before you, to give thanks to you, Father. You have been so good to us, Lord. You have loved us all the days of our lives. Lord, you have poured out your goodness upon us always. In every possible way, Lord, you have shown us your heart. Lord, when we were afraid, you gave us courage. When we were so weak, we didn't know what to do, how to do anything, Lord, you gave us strength. When we couldn't find the way, you gave us wisdom. Father, you gave us your own Son, Jesus, the way, the truth, and the life. And we have come here this day in his name to worship you, to give thanks to you. Thanking you, Lord God, that he went to that cross. He offered himself up. Our Lord Jesus gave himself there on that cross for all of us, and we are so grateful. We are so thankful. We come, Lord, asking that you would draw near to each one of us here. Fill us here with your Holy Spirit. Fill this place with your glory. Lord, we love you. We thank you. We come humbly to you, casting ourselves upon your mercy and your grace, confessing our sin, trusting in your love for us all. We love you. We thank you. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. And amen. Let's give thanks to our God. And to our Lord. You were given a communion packet when you came in. If you could take that and just hold it, don't open it up yet. On that night that our Lord Jesus spent with his disciples, the night before he went to the cross, he took the bread that night, he gave thanks to our Father, and he broke it. He said, "This is my body broken for you. Take and eat this. Do this in remembrance of me." So it's not hard to imagine how shocked they must have been when he spoke those words. It was the same words every year spoken at the Passover, but this year he said, "This is my body." And then he took the cup. And we can imagine that they were stunned. He said, "This is my blood shed for you and for many, the blood of a new covenant, a new promise, shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sin. Drink this and be glad." They would see him hanging on the cross the next day, his body just so horribly beaten. They would see the agony that would come upon him as the Father, what does the Bible tell us, put all the sin of the world on him as he hung there on that cross. He descended into hell there on that cross. And yet here was Jesus saying, "Be glad. Be glad. I'm doing all of this for you. I'm doing all of this to set you free, to bring healing. By my wounds," the prophet Isaiah had said, "you're healed." By the wounds of our Lord Jesus there on that cross, we are healed. We are set free. If you have faith in Jesus, take the bread. Remember him. Be glad. Drink deeply the love of Jesus. If you don't have faith, you can put your faith in him now. The Lord is surely here in this place. So there's a clear tab over the bread. There's another tab over the juice. Our Lord is here.
Far away stood an old rugged cross, the emblem of suffering and shame. And I love that old cross where the dearest and best for a world of lost sinners was slain. So I cherish the old rug. Sing it till my trophies, till my
exchange it someday for a crown.
Oh, the old rugged cross, so despised by the world, has a wondrous attraction for me.
He'll call me someday to my home far away, where his glory forever I'll share. So I'll cherish the old rugged cross till my trophy.
Lord God, we have come to worship you, to give thanks to you, Lord God. We come in the name of Jesus. We come rejoicing in your goodness. We come giving you thanks for Jesus. We love you. We thank you. We praise you. We worship in the name of Jesus. Amen and amen. Let's give thanks to our God and to our Lord.
God is good. Amen. It is good to be here all the time.
All the time.
God is good. Hey, my name is Andy, and welcome to Mount Zion Church. If you are here for the first time with us, we want to say welcome to you. Or if you're online with us, we want to say welcome to you. And when you came in, you received a bulletin. And so we would really appreciate, if this is your first or second time here, jot your name down. There's a little place there. Jot your name down and place it in the offering containers. There's a couple of them around here. Or if you're online with us, there is, in the right-hand corner, it says connect, and you can click on there. We'd like to reach out to you. We'd like to get to know you. And so there's a ton of information in the bulletin to look through and pray through. One other part of the bulletin, there's a place to write down prayer requests. So if you have a prayer request, write it down, place it in the containers. We have a team that prays each week for all of those prayer requests. So when you came in this morning, you were handed a lot of papers. So one of those papers, wait, that's wrong.
Wrong paper.
One of them was about a marriage conference, marriage workshop, rather, that we're having next Sunday evening in the other building. So if you're married or you're thinking about marriage, this would be great to come out. 6 o'clock, the other building will have childcare there as well. So come on out. You'll enjoy it. And it's always good to invest in our marriages, right? Amen. To grow and to never think we have it all together, because no matter how long we've been married, we can always grow and love our spouse more deeply and understand more about them. So I hope you consider coming out next Sunday evening. And then there were some other papers, and so I'm going to turn it over to Lisa, because she's going to tell you about some ladies' opportunities.
Thank you, Andy. Good morning, Mount Zion. I have two announcements for the women of the congregation and the community. The first one is an event we have coming up at the end of this month. It is on Friday night, October 29th, and it is a fellowship night for the women of the church. It's fellowship and service. We have been asked by the Department of Aging to provide some blankets for some of the seniors that they work with. And so we are going to be spending the evening in fellowship and making fleece blankets for some ladies who are local here. I encourage you to come and join us, and I will let you know it is not a tricky project. It is a no-sew project. We will be sitting around tables, chatting away, and putting these blankets together. I encourage you to join us. We will be in the fellowship hall at the other building, and it will be a fun evening. We will be there from 5:30 till 9 o'clock. However, you are welcome to come and go as your schedule permits. I do encourage you to join us that night. And then in November 13th, we will be having our annual Mount Zion Women's Conference with Tracy Tiernan from Shine FM. And as always, it promises to be a good, good day. Tracy will be sharing some teachings with us. And as you know, she teaches us something new every year. She is just amazing with the way she inspires us, with the way she makes us laugh, with the way she brings us closer to our Lord. I encourage you to join us. In addition to Tracy, we will be having testimonies and some other special events. In order to help us during this crazy season of COVID that we're dealing with, we will be only having a half-day conference this year, but I promise you it's going to be chock full of all kinds of wonderful things. So come for the entire morning, and also we're limiting registration this year so that women feel free to spread out as they are comfortable with here in the tent. So do not delay in getting your registration in. We look forward to seeing you ladies at both events. Thank you.
All right. Hey, I want to give thanks for my wife here. Thank you. Lisa and I had the privilege the last couple of weeks. 2 weeks ago, we spent 3 days up in the town where Lisa grew up, Caldwell, New Jersey, up in North Jersey. Got to go to the church where Lisa grew up. And we walked in that sanctuary, and Lisa was just a puddle of tears because the Lord had met her so many times in that sanctuary, her growing up there. And we got to go to the house where she grew up and just a whole lot of places. We came back, we went to Princeton. I was going to seminary at Princeton when we were first married, and our first apartment was a room with a microwave, and no, we didn't even have a microwave. That was down the hall. The women's bathroom was down on the floor below. This was our first apartment, and so we got to go there, and it was just a wonderful time. This past week, we went up for a few days to Rhode Island, where Lisa spent a summer when she was 15 years old. She was a nanny in charge of 5 children for the summer. She was 15 years old, making them all their meals, taking them to the beach, and everybody survived. And so we had a wonderful time up there. And I just want to give thanks for my wife. I want to give thanks for the gift of marriage. I want to ask you, if you are married, I want you to celebrate that marriage. I want you to lift up the goodness that God has shown you in marriage. This nation, this society needs to celebrate marriage, and I'm asking you to do that. So let's give thanks to our God and to our Lord. Every weekend, we have a focus of prayer, and this weekend, we're going to be focusing on praying for courage. And so I'd just like to ask you to join me in prayer right now. Lord, you have told us over and over and over again, do not fear. Be of good courage. And Lord, we see so much fear in this world all around us. We see so much anxiety, so much worry. We see, Lord, so much intimidation. And we are so thankful for you that you have told us we can replace all our fears with faith in you. We can not succumb to the fears of this world. Lord, we can live our lives with courage, with confidence, with determination, because you have promised that you will never leave us. You have promised that you lead us always in triumph. You have told us that you work all things together for good. You have told us, Lord God, that even the gates of hell shall not prevail against your people. And so, Father, we thank you. And we lift up those on our hearts right now, those here in this room right now, those in our hearts right now who are struggling, who are just filled with great anxiety. Lord, we thank you that you are merciful. That, Lord, you come to us. Whatever's going on in our hearts, Lord, there you are. You come to us, Father. We pray that you would set free, that you would deliver. Lord, any one of us here right now from great fear and worry and anxiety, Lord, that you would deliver those on our hearts right now that we're praying for. We pray, Lord, for your people here and in every place, that in the face of a world of so much, Lord, so much darkness, Father, that you would give us this tremendous confidence, this tremendous courage to lift up Jesus. Be with your people in places of great difficulty. Be with your people, Lord, in places of great persecution even. Lord, we thank you, and we lift our hearts before you, and we pray for each and every one of us, even as we're here now, Lord, worshiping you, singing your praise, praying together, pouring out our hearts. We're asking, Father, that you would draw near to us. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. And amen. Hey, I want to invite the men of the congregation. The first weekend in November, we are having a men's retreat coming up in Quarryville, Pennsylvania. It's about an hour's drive from here. Black Rock Retreat Center begins on a Friday night at 7 p.m., ends at 11 a.m. on Sunday morning. We have a guest speaker, Matthew Mayer. Some of you have heard him at our men's gatherings. He has an amazing testimony. He's awesome. And I would invite you to come and join us for that weekend. It's a powerful time, just being together, putting our minds on the Lord for those hours and getting strong in him. And then one more thing that I wanted to share is this coming Tuesday night, I'm going to be leading a session right here in the tent called Questions and Answers with Pastor Craig. So watch out. We're going to be focusing on the future of Mount Zion Church. So with so much upheaval in the world with COVID, with all this disruption that we've had, with so much upheaval in the church here in America, and there really is tremendous upheaval going on in the church in America, we're going to spend that evening, I'm going to share a little bit just about what the scripture says about how do we think about the future, How do we think about tomorrow and next week and next year? So what does the scripture say about how we think about the future? And then I want to share with you that I believe with all of this upheaval, with everything going on, that God has a tremendous future for Mount Zion Church. And I want to share with you why. We'll have a time of questions and answers. So that'll be Tuesday night right here at 7 o'clock. I don't know if there'll be five of us here or 300 people here, but whoever comes, we're going to be here. And then we're going to take it all to prayer. Because I have learned through all these many years now. I've been a pastor 39 years, 34 of them right here. And I have learned that God does nothing except in answer to prayer. When God's people pray, great things happen. And so we're going to take it all to prayer. The day I was ordained, the pastor of my home church took me aside right after my ordination. And he said, "Now, Craig, I don't want you to ever worry about anything in church." He said, "Just pray. Just pray." And those words never left me all these years. Just pray. So we're going to pray here Tuesday night. If you can come, you're very welcome to do so. So as we go to the word this morning, we're going to continue in this series called The Chosen. So this is a series of messages, of sermons, and a series of Bible studies. And all of our connecting groups, these are our small groups, are all doing this same Bible study. And you're welcome to join a connecting group. You're welcome to start a connecting group. You're welcome to pick up the Bible studies. They're all free. They're out at the table out there it has all this information about this series. And it is using a series. Maybe you've seen this video series, The Chosen. If you haven't, I strongly encourage you to get it. You can get the app. You can get a DVD. In the Bible studies each week, they're going to show a clip from The Chosen and then talk about it. Andy, who was up here, did a great job putting this Bible study together. They're great discussion questions. And what this series, the video series, The Chosen, focuses on, and what we're focusing on here, is how Jesus impacted person after person after person that he came across, that he met. Jesus said to his disciples one time, "You didn't choose me, I chose you. I chose to come to your life. I chose to come and change your life." And so we're looking at persons then through this series that Jesus chose, that he came to, that he changed their lives, and we're looking at how he changed their lives. So this morning we're focusing on forgiveness. And in the Bible study, it's going to focus on two persons, Matthew, that man who Jesus met and told him, "Follow me." And Matthew did, became one of that inner core of leadership of this movement of Jesus followers. And also looking at that woman, Mary Magdalene. So looking at two people this week, and for the message this morning, we're just going to focus on Matthew. We looked at Mary Magdalene, some aspects of her life last week. This week, we're going to be looking at Matthew, and we're going to be seeing how he experienced forgiveness. Forgiveness from the Lord and what that meant in his life. What it means to receive forgiveness from God. What it means then to learn from him how to forgive those around us. So first, we're going to lift up four truths about forgiveness. But first, to just think about what exactly does forgiveness, even just the word forgiveness, means. So in the Hebrew of the Old Testament part of the Bible, that first three quarters of your Bible, and then in the Greek of the New Testament, there's a whole number of words that we translate in our English language, forgiveness. Our English language, by the way, consolidated lots of words from many languages, and kind of we have less number of words than many, many languages have. And so there's a whole number of Hebrew words, a whole number of Greek words that were consolidated that when we translated into English, into this word forgiveness. And the primary meaning of those words is to send away or to remove. So if you hurt me, or even more, if you hurt someone I love, there's going to be something between us. There's going to be a wall now between us. You have hurt someone I love. And until I send that wall, until I remove that wall that you built by hurting someone I love, then there will be this thing between us. So when we hurt one of God's children, When we don't obey God, when we don't live as God tells us to live, and therefore we hurt one of his children. And let me put a little parenthesis here. There's no such thing as a private sin. You might think that your disobedience, your sin, is kind of a private thing that's not impacting anyone else. Never true. Never. Even if nobody else knows what's going on, our sin is sin because it hurts other people. Right? So if I hurt one of God's children because I'm not obeying God, then there's a thing between me and God. There's a wall that I'm building between me and God. If I'm just refusing to do what he's telling me to do, then I'm building this wall, I'm creating this distance, and until God forgives me, until he removes that wall, sends it away, I can't have a good relationship with the God I desperately need to have a good relationship with. I've built the wall. I can't take it down because I'm the one who's done wrong. The person who has done the wrong can't take the wall down. It has to be the person who has been wronged. I hurt one of my Heavenly Father's children. He's been wronged. If he and I are going to have a relationship, and we desperately need a relationship with our God. We don't have a relationship with our God. We're just heading, as Jesus said, for that outer darkness, utter separation from anything good, anything at all. But until he removes that wall, I can't have that relationship. And so we're going to look at some truths about forgiveness. And we're going to start with the story of how Matthew met Jesus. So let's look here in the Gospel according to Matthew. So this same Matthew is the Matthew who wrote this biography of Jesus. But let's look here, chapter 9. Jesus is in the town of Capernaum. So it's the biggest of the towns up in the northern part of Israel in Galilee, Capernaum. There's a very heavy Roman presence in Capernaum. Remember that the Romans had conquered Israel 200 years before the time of Jesus. The Romans had endless money, whereas most of all the towns of Galilee were extremely poor in ground. Jesus would have gone to bed hungry many, many nights. This town, there was money, but it was mostly in the hands of the Romans. So as Jesus passed on from there, he's in town, he saw a man called Matthew sitting at the tax booth. So Matthew is a Hebrew name, like Jesus, a Jew, a Hebrew man, but he's sitting at the tax booth, which means he's working for the Romans, which means that he has sold out his own people, because the only reason that the Romans conquered nation after nation after nation was to tax them and tax them and tax them to fund the opulent lifestyles of those back in Rome. And so the Romans just taxed and taxed and taxed the Israelites, taxed them so that people like Jesus growing up in Nazareth were going to bed hungry many nights. The Romans were smart enough not to tax them to death, right? They wanted everybody working. They wanted their empire making money, but they taxed them very badly and just crushed them more and more. And to try to keep all these nations in their empire, what Rome decided to do was try to get everyone to think like Romans think. So they exported all their decadence. So you're walking through the town of Capernaum, you're a Hebrew woman, you're trying to keep a godly life going, but you're walking through town and here's these Roman statues and paintings everywhere, and they're horribly decadent, obscene, violent, they're awful. And now one of your neighbors or one of your family members, maybe you're a cousin to Matthew, or you're Matthew's grandfather, or you're Matthew's mom, and he starts working for them. He has sold out his own people. He sold out everything for one reason, because he could get rich doing it. The Romans knew they needed Israelites to tax fellow Israelites, just like they did in every other nation, because Matthew knew everybody in town. He knew how Jews thought, and Romans needed people like him. And so they allowed people like him to overcharge everyone so that he became extremely wealthy. So Jesus is walking by, he sees Matthew sitting at the tax booth. Now, most teachers or rabbis would have spit on Matthew, would have cussed Matthew out. But Jesus said to him, "Follow me. Follow me." Now, can you imagine the other disciples walking with And they're looking at Matthew and they want to spit on him. They all hate him. But Jesus suddenly says, follow me, to Matthew. His disciples think, are you lost your mind? Are you crazy? What are you doing? And Matthew's sitting there, a rabbi said, follow me. And he rose and followed him. Everybody, the only people who didn't hate Matthew, the Romans, even though he's working for them, they still hate him. They hate everybody. The soldiers there, they hate everybody. They'd rather be back home in Rome, right? But the only people who would have had anything to do with somebody like Matthew were other tax collectors or the most notorious of the sinners of town. But now a rabbi, a man of God, says, follow me. We can't even begin to imagine how that would have hit Matthew. But at verse 10, right? So he rose, he followed him. And as Jesus reclined at table in the house, now if we read in the gospel according to Luke, Matthew arranges for this big dinner gathering now in his house that night, that evening. So most of the Israelites, the Jews, the Romans had all the money. They were all poor. Their houses were about as big as your bedroom. That's all. But Matthew's become a wealthy man. So he has a big house. So he creates this big dinner party. So as Jesus reclined at table in the house. Now let's again think about Peter, about John, as the others. Jesus and his disciples are there. His disciples would have been walking into Matthew's house like this. They would have been extremely uncomfortable. Extremely to be walking into the home of somebody like this. Sitting down at his table, and there are many tax collectors and sinners who came. They're all extremely uncomfortable, except Jesus. Because Jesus is the one who said, Matthew, follow me. Now, at verse 11, what's going on? When the Pharisees saw this, so this religious group, the ones who are always dogging Jesus, right, always coming against Jesus. Now, why would they even see what's going on in Matthew's house? Well, people kept their doors open. In fact, they didn't even have doors like we have. They had pieces of leather they'd roll down at night. They'd keep them open. A famous rabbi is in town. People are kind of following. The Pharisees are looking in. They can't believe it. So they said to his disciples, why does your teacher eat with tax collectors and sinners? Say, that's disgusting. You hang out with people like that. Why does your teacher eat with tax collectors and sinners? So Jesus knows what's going on at verse 12 then. When he heard it, he said, those who are well have no need of a physician, but those who are sick. So he's saying to the Pharisees, all right, you think you're so holy. You think you're so good. You think you're so righteous. Well, then you don't need a doctor. But those who are sick, who know they're sick, they know they need a doctor. So at verse 13 then, go and learn what this means. And he quotes from the prophet Hosea. He's talking to the Pharisees. I desire mercy and not sacrifice. For I came not to call the righteous, but sinners. So let's lift this up first of all. That Jesus is very ready to bring forgiveness to you. He's very ready to bring forgiveness to your life. He sought out Matthew. Matthew didn't see Jesus walk by and get out of the tax booth and run after him begging for forgiveness. Jesus sought him out. The other people sitting around that table that night didn't have to follow Jesus up to the top of a mountain somewhere. Jesus came to Matthew's house and sat down at table with them. He is very ready to forgive our sin. Very ready to remove, to take this wall that we've built between ourselves and him and send it away. He's very ready. Now, persons like the Pharisees, right? What wall? What wall? I'm good. We're good. I'm good. People like Matthew, being spit on every day, hated, he knew what a hot mess he was. He was not in any denial about the reality of his life. And Jesus was very ready to bring forgiveness to his life. Matthew, of all people, becomes one of the 12, one of the inner core of leadership of this Jesus movement. Look in the prophet, look to the book of Nehemiah here. So the story of Nehemiah is a very long story. We don't have time to get into all of it. But Nehemiah is praying a long prayer here. And so he's praying to the Father. He says, but they, he's talking about his fellow Israelites and back through the history of Israel, but they and our fathers acted presumptuously and stiffened their neck and did not obey your commandments. Stiffened their neck, stubborn. He's saying to our God, but we've been stubborn. We've acted presumptuously. We've just been prideful, arrogant, stubborn. We have not obeyed your commandments. We've done everything but do what you've told us to do. At verse 17, they refuse to obey. Refuse to obey. God tells us and tells us and tells us and tells us. But we refuse to obey. They refuse to obey and were not mindful of the wonders that you performed among them. Now he's praying about specifically that time when God had delivered them from their slavery in Egypt. They were foolishly had left. They were slaves in Egypt. And God, after miracle, delivers them from their slavery. But now they're needing to walk through this long wilderness back to the land God had given them. And they said, we're not doing it. We're not doing it. How many times we are not mindful of the wonders that he has performed in our lives. We forget about how blessed we are, how good. We start feeling sorry for ourselves. We start getting frustrated and angry about the way our lives are going, forgetting that we are wealthier. Everyone in this room is wealthier than 96% of people in the world. Forgetting that we have food in our bellies, roof over our head, warm clothes on our bodies, and we get stubborn, stiff-necked, prideful and arrogant. So they stiffened their neck and appointed a leader to return to their slavery in Egypt. They said, no, we're not doing it. We're going back. We liked it better there. But you, Nehemiah is still praying, but you are a God ready to forgive. Ready to forgive. Wow. Gracious and merciful, slow to anger, and abounding in steadfast love, and did not forsake them. There they were, despite all that you did. You were so good to them, so good to them. You sent a man, Moses. You raised Moses up. Moses was a murderer. He had murdered someone. And you got hold of that man's heart. You changed everything about him. You sent him down there, and through him, you did miracle after miracle to lead them out of their slavery. They had no hope, but you delivered them from their slavery, and now they want to go back, and still, you're ready to forgive them. This is the true and living God. Jesus is ready. He's very ready to bring forgiveness to your life. Whatever it is that you've built between you and God, he's ready to remove it, to send it away. Look in 2 Corinthians here. The Apostle Paul writes these words about our Father and Jesus. He says, for our sake, he, our Heavenly Father, made him, Jesus, to be sin who knew no sin. As Jesus was on that cross, the Father was bringing all the sin of all the world on him there so that Jesus, who was holy and pure and good, became sin. He became all the wickedness and selfishness of the world. He became your sin and my sin on that cross so that in him, in Jesus, we might become the righteousness of God, so that our sin would be removed from us. It would be sent away. It would no longer be between us and God, so that we would have righteousness, right? A right relationship with God. If you're here and you're believing that there's no forgiveness for you, he is very ready to forgive. You know, at the end of the service, we're going to have baptisms here in the baptismal pool as we sing our last song this morning. And maybe you didn't come ready to be baptized today, but maybe you know the Lord speaking to your heart right now. Because what does the scripture say about being baptized, right? That it's a washing away of our sin. It's a way of experiencing in a tangible, physical way, this reality that our God is very ready to wash away our sin. And I would invite you, if you know there's a huge wall between you and God, I would invite you to walk up here. Walk up here when we're singing our last song. Walk up here, confess your faith in Jesus, and be baptized, because he's very ready to forgive. So let's go to the Gospel of Luke now. Now, surprisingly, what we just read about Matthew is about all we know of Matthew. That's about it. We don't know a whole lot about him, except that he was a hated tax collector, sold out to wickedness, and Jesus forgave his sin, sent it away, and he became a follower of Jesus. Now, let's look here, not about Matthew, but Matthew would have been here with Jesus. So one of the Pharisees asked Jesus to eat with him, and he went into the Pharisee's house and reclined at table. So again, a wealthier person has a bigger house. So this Pharisee invites Jesus, so he comes in and reclines. It always says reclines because they didn't have chairs. So they were low tables, they reclined around the table. At verse 37, and behold, a woman of the city who was a sinner, a notorious sinner, when she learned that he was reclining at table in the Pharisee's house, brought an alabaster flask of ointment. So again, the doors were always open, right? People could look in the doors. And when there's somebody like a famous rabbi like Jesus there, people were welcome to come in and stand around the walls. They couldn't sit down at the table unless they were an invited guest. But you could stand around the walls and listen to the conversation going on. So this woman, now a notorious sinner, she brings this flask of ointment. So without soap and shampoo and all that, they used ointments, perfumes, right? Just for cleanliness. At verse 38 then, and standing behind him, behind Jesus at his feet are out behind him from the table toward the wall, weeping, she began to wet his feet. She's crying, the tears are falling on his feet. And then she kneels down and wiped them with the hair of her head, which gives us a clue why she was a notorious sinner. All women kept their hair up. That was considered modest. The only women who let their hair down in public were prostitutes. Now she's kneeling down at his feet. She's drying his feet with her hair, the hair of her head, and kissed his feet and anointed them with the ointment. So in that society, men wouldn't shake hands the way we do. They would kiss each other on the cheek. She kneels down. She's kissing his feet. She's kissing his feet and pouring this perfume. It might be hospitality of a wealthy person to put some ointment on your head, some perfume on your head when you came in, but she pours all this ointment on his feet. So at verse 39 then, when the Pharisee who had invited him saw this, he said to himself, if this man were a prophet, he would have known who and what sort of woman this is who is touching him, for she is a sinner. Now we're looking for a great truth about forgiveness, right? So this Pharisee, now he's kind of thinking kind of weird, like if he were a prophet, he'd know who this woman is. Anyone would know who this woman was. Her hair's down like that. Anyone would know who she is. But this Pharisee, he just doesn't like Jesus. None of them did. So he's just thinking stuff about him. At verse 40, and Jesus answering him said to him, Simon. So the Pharisee's name was Simon. I have something to say to you. He answered, say it, teacher. Jesus knows what he's thinking. It was pretty obvious to everyone sitting at the table, I would imagine, the look on Simon's face as this woman walked in the room, as she's kneeling down at Jesus' feet, kissing his feet, pouring the oil on his feet. So at verse 41 then, a certain moneylender, so Jesus is talking to Simon, had two debtors. One owed 500 denarii, a whole bunch of money, and the other 50, not too much. So at verse 42, you know the story. When they could not pay, he canceled the debt of both. Now, which of them will love him more? And Simon knows he's just been busted. He's just been busted by Jesus. So he answers at verse 43. Simon answered, the one, I suppose, for whom he canceled the larger debt. Yeah, of course. Of course. And so Jesus said to him, you have judged rightly. Simon, are you even thinking about what you're saying? Are you even thinking about this at all, Simon? Why do you think this woman is weeping? Why do you think she's kissing my feet? Why, Simon? So at verse 44, then turning toward the woman, he said to Simon, so Jesus is looking at the woman now. People like Simon would have looked at her and looked away. Had nothing to do with her. But Jesus turns to the woman. He's looking at her. He says, do you see this woman? Do you even see her? Simon, do you even see that this woman is somebody's baby girl? Do you even see her at all, Simon? I entered your house. You gave me no water for my feet, but she has wet my feet with her tears and wiped them with her hair. It was common courtesy to wash someone's feet, but you didn't do that. But she has, at verse 45, you gave me no kiss. Like, you didn't shake my hand. You gave me no kiss, but from the time I came in, she has not ceased to kiss my feet. What are you seeing, Simon? What are you seeing? At verse 46, you did not anoint my head, but she has anointed my feet with ointment. At verse 47, therefore, I tell you, her sin. Now, a lot of times we read this backwards. Therefore, I tell you, her sins, which are many, are forgiven, for she loved much. Now, we read that backwards. A lot of times we think that what he just said was, because she loved much, her sins were forgiven. No, he's saying, she is so grateful. She is so thankful for the forgiveness that I have brought to her life. She's has many sins in her life. She's built a huge wall between herself and God. She's stumbling toward the outer darkness. But she's been forgiven, and she's so grateful. He's still talking to Simon, but he who is forgiven little loves little. Simon, you're looking down your nose at her. You're judging her nonstop. You think she's despicable. You don't. You hate her. But Simon, maybe you need some forgiveness. Maybe you need a little forgiveness. And Simon, you obviously haven't received it, because you have no gratitude in your heart. And so at verse 48 then, he said to her, and he says to the woman, your sins are forgiven. Your sins are forgiven. Who knows what happened to this woman that took her to that place in life? Who knows? But Jesus said, your sins, the wall that has been between you and your Father, has been sent away. It's been removed. So at verse 49, of course, Simon and his friends are grumbling. Those who were at table with him began to say among themselves, who is this who even forgives sins? But Jesus is still talking to her at verse 50. He said to the woman, your faith has saved you. Go in peace. Your faith has saved you. Go in peace. So what's the second great truth? Our first truth, he's very ready to bring forgiveness to our lives. Secondly, we receive that forgiveness by putting our faith in him. By turning to him, by putting our faith in him. Why did she come in? Had she seen him maybe walk by out in the street? Maybe he turned and looked in her eyes. Maybe Mary Magdalene, who traveled with Jesus often and seems to have had a very similar life to this woman, maybe somehow Mary Magdalene had talked to her and told her about this Jesus. We don't know why, but she came in to Simon's house and knelt down and was kissing the feet of this famous rabbi. She had faith that he wouldn't hate her, that he wouldn't spit on her. She had faith that he would bring mercy and forgiveness. To receive this forgiveness, it's like there's a gift being offered to you. You have to lift up your hands to receive it. You receive it by putting your faith in this Jesus. Faith, you can't prove it. No preacher can prove that your sin is forgiven. You can't prove it. It can't be demonstrated in some tangible way that you can see. But you're putting your faith that what Jesus did on the cross, he did for you. That when he was on the cross, he took your sin from you. There's a fancy word in the Bible, expiation. It means removal. He removed our sin from us, took it on himself, so it was no longer between us and our God. You put your faith in Jesus, and you receive this forgiveness. Now, we say, wait a minute, Pastor Craig, there's got to be more than that. There's got to be. But here he just said it. Your faith has saved you. Your sins are forgiven. Your faith has saved you. Go in peace. Shalom. All is well. All is well. All right, let's look at a third truth about forgiveness. We'll come back to this. Let's look at a third truth in the Gospel of Matthew. So after Jesus taught them that prayer that we often pray, we call our Lord's Prayer, he says to them, if you forgive others their trespasses, their sins, your heavenly Father will also forgive you. At verse 15. But if you do not forgive others their trespasses, neither will your Father forgive your trespasses. Here we see this third great truth that Jesus teaches us to forgive others as we have been forgiven. Now, you might say, well, wait a minute, Pastor Craig. I don't see anything here of him teaching us how. He teaches us how to forgive. He teaches us to forgive. He teaches us how to forgive. I don't see him anywhere here teaching us how to forgive. He just says, if I don't forgive, I won't be forgiven. Well, let's go in chapter 5 of Matthew. Look at this. Blessed are the merciful, those who are full of mercy, those who are ready to forgive, those who are ready to send away that wall that someone else has built between them and that other person. Blessed are the merciful, those who are full of mercy, for they shall receive mercy. They, the key word there is they, for they shall receive mercy. Well, again, Pastor Craig, you're telling me, yeah, he's telling us to forgive. He's telling us to be full of mercy. He's not telling me how. Well, let's look in the Gospel of Luke. Another time Jesus is talking. He says, judge not. To judge is to draw a line and say, you are despicable, but you aren't. Judge not, you and you will not be judged. Condemn not, and you will not be condemned. Forgive, and you will be forgiven. At verse 38, give and it will. In other words, give mercy and you'll receive mercy. Give condemnation and you'll receive condemnation. Give forgiveness, you'll be forgiven. Give judgment and you'll be judged. Give and it will be given to you. And now it's like you're in a marketplace and the vendor's pouring grain in your basket. And if he's a kind vendor, he shakes it and then he can pour more in. Then he presses it down, shakes it some more, he can pour more in. Good measure, press down. You give mercy in abundance, you'll receive mercy in abundance. You give judgment in abundance, you receive judgment in abundance. Good measure, pressed down, shaken together, running over, will be put into your lap. For with the message you use, it will be measured back to you. Well, again, Pastor Craig, you said that he teaches us how to forgive. I only see him here teaching me to forgive. Now, what does the Bible say? That the fear of God is the beginning of wisdom. The fear of God is the beginning of wisdom. Right here, Jesus is giving us the wisdom that if I do not forgive, I will not be forgiven. That's teaching me how to forgive. He's teaching me, Craig, just do it. Just do it. It's like riding a bicycle. You get on the bicycle. Nobody can teach you how to ride a bicycle until you get on a bicycle and start to ride it. And mom or dad hold you as you start to ride it, but you start to do it and you get it. And here's Jesus saying, do it. Do not hold on to that grievance. Do not hold on to that bitterness. Do not hold on to that resentment. You remove the wall. You send the wall away that person has built between you and that person. Learn from Jesus then how to forgive. How to forgive. If we will not forgive, we will not receive forgiveness. Now, what did Jesus say one time? Don't cast your pearls before swine, lest they turn and trample you underfoot. There are persons who must be loved from a distance. There are persons who will trample you underfoot again and again and again and again and again. Your pearls are your love. Your pearls are that closeness. There are some persons that, yes, we must forgive. We do not hold bitterness and resentment against them, but we create a boundary. We create not a wall, a boundary. Because this person tramples over me, or this person tramples over people I love again and again and again and again. And so some people we love from a distance. We don't keep that wall of anger and resentment, but we love them from a distance. You hurt somebody I love, then I'm going to put up a boundary. I'm going to forgive you. I'm going to love you. But I'm not going to let you hurt someone I love. Because I'm not going to allow that person I love to be trampled underfoot again and again and again. So we learn from Jesus how to forgive. Now, there's one last thing. Let's look here in the book of Acts in chapter 2. Peter has just, you know, I learned from Peter how to preach because Peter has just preached a very long sermon. Somebody say amen to that, okay? So Peter has just preached a very long sermon. Peter said to them at the end, repent, turn to Jesus. Turn to him, put your faith in him, repent. Turn away from this road you've been walking, this sin that has built a wall between you and God. Turn to him, put your faith in him, repent means turn, put your faith in him, and be baptized. Every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ, for the forgiveness of your sins, and you will receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. You know, I've said many times, I'm a very simple man. The Bible is actually a very simple book, right? It's not deep, heavy philosophy. It's a very simple book. Here's God saying, turn to Jesus, put your faith in him, be baptized, and you'll receive this forgiveness. You'll receive this forgiveness and you will receive the presence of God, the gift of the Holy Spirit. God himself will come to dwell in your heart. And so what are we learning about forgiveness here? We're learning to put our faith in Jesus and be baptized to receive that forgiveness, to receive that forgiveness and the gift of the Holy Spirit. Can I explain what it is about being dunked in a pool of water? No, of course not. Can I explain how it is that Jesus removes the wall between us and God? No, of course not. But can I read that he promises to forgive? Yes. And so perhaps you find yourself today as someone who you know there is this great wall. There is this separation between you and him. You know that there is this separation which has you then only heading farther and farther away from him into a greater and greater darkness. And here he's calling to your heart. He's saying, turn to me. Put your faith in me. Turn to me. Put your faith in me. Come, be baptized. And yes, I wash away the sin, the stain of sin from your life. Yes, I fill you with the presence of the Holy Spirit. He's a great God, amen? He is a great, great God. Let's pray together. Father, we thank you and we love you. And we lift up our hearts before you. We ask, Lord God, that you would draw near to each one of us. We ask, Lord God, that you would fill our hearts with this faith. Father, for someone here who's never had faith in Jesus, Lord, call to that heart now. Call to that heart now, Lord God. You've promised this incredible gift of forgiveness. You've promised, Lord, to send away all the junk from our lives, Lord God. And so we ask, Lord God, that you would touch that heart. Just even if it's one heart here right now who's never had faith, touch that heart right now. For each and every one of us, Lord, we pray that you would increase our faith. Give us greater faith to believe, greater faith to know that you never turn from us, you never leave us. You're very ready to forgive. Oh Lord, we pray that you would teach us how then. Just give us, Lord, that first lesson that we must forgive to receive forgiveness, that we must give mercy to be filled with mercy. And so, Lord God, help us to let it go, to send it away. Give us the wisdom, Lord God, when there are persons who must be loved from a distance. And Father, we pray. We pray for those you're calling even this day to be baptized here in this tent right now. We pray that you would call to that heart. We love you. We thank you, Father. We pray for all those on our hearts right now. We pray for those right now on our hearts who are far from you. Please, Lord God, reach to those hearts right now. right now, Lord God. We know nothing's too difficult for you. Reach to those hearts right now. We pray, Lord God, in Jesus' name. Amen. And amen. Let's stand and sing to our great God. You're welcome. Come, be baptized in his name.
Wonderful, merciful Savior, precious Redeemer and friend. Who would have thought that a lamb could rescue the souls of men? Oh, you rescue the souls of men.
So good to us. Go with us this day, Lord God. Send us forth rejoicing in your mercy. Send us forth rejoicing in Jesus. We thank you. We love you. We praise you in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. Let's give thanks to our God. Say hello to someone you don't know before you leave.